Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. A warm welcome to you on this Easter Sunday to Rosedale United Church here in Toronto. My name is Kristin Philipson. I'm one of the ministers here, and in a moment you'll meet my colleague, Reverend Roberta Howey. And throughout the service, you will see some of the members of our stellar choir who have been coordinated in their efforts this morning by our music director, Susan Suchard. It's a joy and a privilege to share this Easter morning with you. None of us expected to be doing our Easter service online a year ago when we were thinking about Easter 2021. But here's the thing about Easter. It is something to celebrate, whether we're in church or at home, whether we're feeling up this year or whether we've been feeling down, whether we're with people or on our own, Easter is a celebration of love. It is a celebration of God's love that can meet us wherever we are, whether we are in the hospital, whether we are struggling under pressures from work, whether we're happy about the continued lockdown or whether we are ready to break free. Wherever this Easter finds you and wherever you're at, spiritually or emotionally, I know this is a challenging time. Easter is simply the proclamation that there is nothing that can separate us from God's love. St. Paul, the very first Christian evangelist, said it best. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Today we celebrate stones rolled away, the tomb of our world opened wide, that the dawn has come, that our lives can be renewed and restored, that we can find release from what weighs on us, that we are lifted by divine power and possibility. Jesus said, "I have come that they might have life and have life in all its fullness." And so, with these words, I light our Easter candle. And I hope that light and warmth greet you wherever you are this morning.
He was cut off out of the land.
Thank you.
I invite you to join me in a time of centering prayer. God of power, God of people, you are the life of all that lives, energy that fills the earth, vitality that brings to birth, impetus in making whole whatever is bruised or broken. In you, we grow to know the truth that sets all creation free. You are the song the whole earth sings, the promise liberation brings now and forever. Amen.
The Son of Hi, I'm Joel.
And I'm Kessa. And we are the parents of a blended family of four school-age kids.
Early in the pandemic, a little over a year ago, we both lost our jobs. We're both both designers in the city, and both lost our jobs within about 2 weeks of each other. And through the course of the pandemic, dealt with a lot of stress, some mental health challenges with the kids, obviously our own stresses of finances and work and trying to stay connected to friends and family.
Yeah, and I joke that we went into the pandemic as newlyweds and have kind of emerged, it feels like, with a much more mature marriage, I would say, and really had a year that I would say almost took the rose-colored glasses off of marriage and really just, I'd say, forced both of us to really lean on each other, which, you know, we certainly had in the past, you know, 2 years prior to the pandemic, but this was different because it wasn't, you know, we were both going through very, you know, similar feelings of loss and uncertainty and all of those stresses. So we were actually having to learn to support each other when both of us were actually feeling in need of support as well. So I would say in terms of how love sustained us is it really, we became, had to learn, I think, to support each other even when we weren't at our best. So it didn't feel so much like a passing of the baton that often happens. We would, we really had to lean each other and learn when we weren't able to offer that support, when we were just, you know, really had to share when we were both feeling completely depleted, and learn to give each other the space to do that too. And so yeah, there was, I'd say the real silver lining of this time was the kind of deepening of the love that we experienced and how to kind of go through difficult things together.
First and foremost, what sustains me is I have to remind myself to take a step back a lot of the time and to breathe, because I'll hold my breath more often than I recognize. It also really sustains me to remind myself that I can only control myself and my actions and the way that I respond to things.
Part of it is being that so many of us have gone through the same thing together, that so whether it's family, whether it's friends, people at the university, colleagues, there's been a collective sharing of the burden of grief, of lament, of trauma, and that there is, maybe surprisingly, there's hope in that collective sharing that has helped to tell each other how we're doing, to have somebody ask that question, and not to necessarily anticipate a coherent response. And that's okay, that there hasn't been a sense of judgment about how we're doing. It's just to be with one another, to ask the question, and to hear the answer. I've found that remarkably sustaining, and believe that through all of those conversations, God has been part of that. God has allowed each of us to engage in that format. And I've increasingly believed, as I've been working in the hospital, how much God works in mysterious ways.
Positivity, and I get a lot of that through my faith, obviously. The cycle of the seasons, you know, I have been hanging on for spring and it has not let me down. That just never ceases to amaze. And just really being present and focusing on what's good that's right in front of me now, I think that's made a really big difference.
Mm-hmm. Definitely having the habit to take a moment and pause and ask my higher power, God, for help. Definitely doing that frequently. and prayer and taking moments of quiet time, you know, just quiet and connection to my friends.
Our reading this morning is the Easter story as told in the Gospel of John. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter then came out with the other disciple, and they went toward the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying and the napkin which had been laid on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, the one who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Saying this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and said to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. God always blesses the reading of the gospel. Thanks be to God.
Jesus meets us, risen from the tomb. Lovingly he greets us, scatters fear and gloom. Let his church with gladness hymns of triumph sing. For her Lord now liveth, death hath lost its sting. Thine is the glory, risen, conquering Son. Endless is the victory, thou our death hast won. No more he doubt thee, glorious Prince of
In many ways, this still doesn't feel like Easter 2021. but still feels a bit like Lent 2020. It isn't April, but it's the 378th day of March last year. We are still waiting at the tomb. We're still waiting for the ending of this story where we can dance and sing and hug and be together. This is one of the great challenges and frustrations we have with Easter. We enter Lent in solemn seriousness. We run into Holy Week and we wave palms in the air. And then we see Good Friday and we breeze past it because it's sad and we don't wish to wallow. We wish to run straight past the cross and wait at the tomb before Jesus is even dead. We know the ending. We want to get to that part. We as a society love a happily ever after, where the main characters meet and fall in love, the hero saves the day, the magic spell is broken, where our main character gets the medal or the job. We crave them because they tie up all the messiness of life so nicely. We know what we're gonna get when we start that story. It's what makes this year so hard, since we don't see the conclusion. Ready for an ending that doesn't feel like it's anywhere close to arriving, waiting for a clear answer and a path forward to continue the rituals of our lives, birthdays and graduations and career moves and weddings and travel plans. We're tired of not being able to be together and do this in person. We're ready for the ending of this story. We need the ending of this story. This past year, the world has been turned upside down. Even last Easter, we were so focused on dealing with the shock of unprecedented times, I don't think it hit most of us, certainly not me. We were scrambling week to week to figure out how to put stuff on Facebook and how to make Zoom work and how do we even get music in here. The universe, in my professional opinion, lost the plot. We don't know which page we are on. No one knows where our ending is. Where is the final chapter where we say we're overcome with joy? No, we're forced to sit at the cross. The tomb isn't ready. We encounter a harsh reminder. No one really knows the ending. No one is here because they're able to control their own path. We're all just doing our best in a world of endless possibilities of getting it wrong. It doesn't take much for us to lose stability in a cycle of rituals and seasons that we have become so reliant upon. Take a moment and sit with that feeling. It's one that we started, honestly, last year, but we delved into it on Good Friday. It's the one that's maybe in your chest right now, a year of solitary grief and anger and sorrow and fear, a weight that makes it hard to breathe. A year of not knowing what we can do because it seemed like everything we thought we could do was the wrong move. There must be something that we can do in the wake of tragedy. And so we make a list of things that we can do. We'll write cards and letters and postcards and text messages and emails. We'll do more phone calls, double the phone calls, triple the phone calls. If I never hear the phrase, "Let's hop on Zoom again," I will die happy. A year of refreshing the COVID test result page and reading up on which mask is safest, still with that air of uncertainty A year of trying to hold it together when the world is in chaos and we feel we must do something. Of emptying the ocean with a thimble. A year of moral and spiritual exhaustion. Folks, we're empty. We are Mary, approaching the tomb with, yes, a glimmer of hope, but with the grief of what has happened and is happening and will probably continue to happen. Mary, one of the most faithful and loyal disciples of the now dead Jesus, who is preparing to do something. She wants to scream. She wants to break windows and start a riot. She wants justice for a man whose state powers executed. She wants the pain to end. She wants this story to end. Mary approaches the tomb to prepare Jesus' body for the next stage of burial rituals. She arrives. The rock has moved. The tomb empty. Without waiting for her mind to catch up, her feet are already running to Simon, Peter, and the beloved disciple, who all race to the cave and again find it empty. The beloved disciple goes home. He thinks he understands. There's some confusion, but he knows he needs to go home. Simon Peter is sad. He goes home to grieve. Mary, well, for Mary, this is not a celebration. This is a cruel joke. Someone took their beloved teacher. Someone stole the final bit of dignity from them. The others all have left. Mary has to stay, much like us, unable to move forward, unable to go back. We sit with her as stuck disciples, wondering where this happily ever after is. Voices puncture her grief, call her back from the void. Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek? Mary. It is none other than the risen Christ, here and now, ready before her as friend and teacher and Messiah. Christ defeats death. Christ is risen, and they live happily ever after. Like many Easters of years past, we could, if we wanted to, let this be the end of the story. The church sometimes treats Ascension and Pentecost as more of an epilogue after the main event is done. It would be very easy for us to do that. But this year, where does that leave us? Where are we in this picture as we wait at the tomb of a world which has gone to rest for a lot longer than 3 days? I ask us to do what God has shown us is possible. Let's turn this all upside down. Easter isn't the end of the story. It is the beginning. Once upon a time, a man who had been killed by the state came back from the dead after 3 days. He greeted one of his friends, named Mary, near the tomb that he was buried in. They laugh and smile at each other. The man, named Jesus, then tells Mary, "Go to my brothers and tell them I am ascending to my Father and your Father, my God and your God." Mary ran off to do so, and the true adventure began. End of chapter 1. Easter isn't about tying off the story of Jesus with a little bow, with all of the messy plot lines tied up. The story of Christ's resurrection is one that starts with the everlasting love of a God, a force so awesome it defies our sensibilities. It is about endless possibilities, the endless range of God's love, the endless stories that could be told because of the simple fact that God so loved the world, that God sent God's Son to liberate every single person who had been told they do not deserve anything. To lead us to a kingdom of heaven, to be the greatest miracle for us all. Jesus' story doesn't end today. Our story doesn't end today. In the midst of chaos and suffering, our story begins today with the resurrection of a million possibilities to love. Mary will go tell the others that Christ is risen, the first person to preach the gospel. Then they will tell others who share it further and further, and from there, endless opportunities grow for all who wish to be the body of Christ, up to and including here and now. Endless chances for followers to declare that love is stronger than hatred or fear or death, and to build justice and hope in their path. Now, we are human. We will get it wrong sometimes. We will make mistakes, we'll stumble, we'll forget things, we'll forget the gospel. But God doesn't say, and they failed, so the end. God says they made mistakes, but they kept going. And we will tell the beginning of the story again, one of my love for all of us, for all of you. We will not be asked to cut our grief short, but to remember that love is the final word, not death. We start the story with love defeating death. We end the story with love defeating death. And in between is the greatest adventure that you and I will ever have. This is the heart of Easter for me. God sees our humanity, and the very first thing she writes in our story is her love for us. A love so strong it defeated death itself, a love full of miracles and hope, one that turns tyrants on their heads and lifts up the oppressed. God wrote that story for you, for me, for everyone. God so loves you that God defeated death and raised miracles and created you out of stardust and love. There is no way that the story just ends today. It begins here and now. The story, the story, is not yet finished, not even close. Each day we are here, we are able to write our own narrative into the universe. So we don't end our story today with grief and bewilderment, but with joy in the truth. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Go and tell them all. Come. Let us go to the tomb. Let us greet Christ. And let's start the story together. He is risen. Hallelujah.
what the Lord has done in me. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me. It's what the Lord has done in me. It's what the Lord has done in me.
And so as we close this gathering, this time of worship, and prepare to go into the rest of our day and into our week, a time of closing prayer. Let us pray. Creator of mists and mystery, you roll away the stones to open us to your life, to let your story shine out to all the world. Give us hope, living God, hope in our hands to open doors, hope in our eyes to see possibilities, hope in our heart to live by faith, for in hope you roll away stones. Amen.
Hark!
of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing.
So we go, like the woman who ran to share the good news of the empty tomb, let us go forth with joy. Like the travelers walking on the Emmaus road, let us go forth with opened eyes. Like the disciples receiving the Holy Spirit, let us go forth with peace. Like Thomas filled with doubt, let us go forth with faith. Like fishers pulling heavy nets, let us go forth with abundant life. Happy Easter to all of you, and have a wonderful day.